Good Friday evening. I'm Chris Matthews in Washington. It's been 3 days since Tuesday's referendum on the president, and the blue wave keeps growing, swamping more and more Republicans. House Democrats needed only 23 new seats and are now looking to win almost twice as many. Meanwhile, they may be on their way to another seat in the U.S. Senate. There's surprising hope for Democrats in four contests where votes are still being counted. In Arizona, Kyrsten Sinema, who was behind when we signed off Tuesday night, has taken the lead over Republican Martha McSally. Down in Florida, Governor Rick Scott's lead over Senator Bill Nelson is down from 56,000 votes now to just 15,000 votes, well within the margin that would force a recount. The Florida governor's race between Democrat Andrew Gillum and Republican Ron DeSantis is also now within the threshold for a recount. In Georgia, Democrat Stacey Abrams is also hoping to force a runoff. While Republicans seeing the Democrats' good fortune latched out, trying to spread doubt about the electoral counts by claiming fraud. Here's Governor Scott accusing Democrats of, you got it, stealing the election.
We've all seen the incompetence and irregularities in vote tabulations in Broward and Palm Beach for years. Well, here we go again. I will not sit idly by while unethical liberals try to steal this election from the great people of Florida.
Liberals. Well, President Trump on a flight to France today took shots at the Democrats' advances, tweeting 9 times about the 3 states that are still in contention. For the very latest, I'm joined by Steve Kornacki, NBC News national political correspondent. Steve, I can't believe we're still on election night, but here we are, election night Friday.
And Chris, I'll tell you, it really does feel like an election night because as you were giving us that introduction, we just got a giant batch of new votes I can tell you about in that Arizona Senate race. About 80,000 just came in, and you can see what it's done to the race here. These are from Maricopa County. This was just announced in the last 2 minutes. Kyrsten Sinema, the Democrat, her lead at the when you came on the air, her lead in this Senate race was 10,000 votes. It is now 22,000 votes because of this new batch that just came in. Again, they are from Maricopa County, biggest county in the state by far, around Phoenix. The margin here, I'm just looking at the math right now to see exactly what happened. It was about 54,000 new votes that came in for Kyrsten Sinema, and it is about 32,000 new votes that came in for Martha McSally. So what's happening here, Chris, is Arizona is a heavy mail-in voting state. So what they have been counting over the last couple days in Maricopa in particular are ballots that were mailed last weekend, you know, a couple days before the election, and the expectation had been that they would favor Sinema a little. I think they're favoring her more than was expected. There are still, even with this batch of votes we just got, there are still probably about 375,000 votes in Arizona yet to be counted. Again, a lot of them from Maricopa County. Now, Republicans are saying they hope that the final batch, which are going to be ballots people dropped off at the polling place on Election Day, might favor McSally. But she's starting to fall behind in this race and, you know, might get to a place here where there just aren't enough votes that are favorable enough to her. Yeah. This is very good news for Sinema, what just happened in the last couple minutes.
What about Florida? Let's take a look at what's going on with there, because a lot of us have been trying to figure out what goes on with Broward County and why it's Friday night and we're still counting.
Yeah, so this is the deal in the Senate race right here. The margin, as you can see, Nelson is about 15,000, a little less than 15,000 votes behind Rick Scott. Now, you can see this is 0.2 of a point. If it's less than 0.25%, it will automatically trigger not just a recount, but, you know, a manual recount. So this means they're not running them through the machines. They're also going to take them out and examine them by hand. It's that close. We expect between now and tomorrow night, the deadline for these counties to finalize their counts. We do expect there are provisional ballots from around the state that are going to be counted. Expect them to favor Nelson, probably going to net him a couple thousand more votes. So that should shrink a little, but may still be behind Rick Scott there going into the recount. Broward, you mentioned, though, this is very interesting because obviously huge county, 2 million people live here, hugely Democratic county. Here's the thing they have found in this Senate race in Florida, about 25,000 fewer votes were cast in the Senate race than in the governor's race. People got the same ballot, and on 25,000 ballots or so, there was just no marking on the Senate race. And what it appears happened here is that the design of the ballot in Broward County essentially took that Senate race and buried it in the lower left corner of the ballot. You had a big, long instruction column. The Senate race was down here. Meanwhile, the governor's race is squarely in the middle, top of the page, widely spaced out. And so did about 25,000 people in this county of 2 million, this heavily Democratic county of 2 million, did they just miss the Senate race? That could potentially, when you look at how Nelson is winning Broward here, if those 25,000, we didn't see anything like this in any other county in the state, if those 25,000 had voted at that rate, you're talking 8,000-10,000 extra votes there for Nelson that he would net in a race where right now, again, statewide, less than 15,000.
It reminds me of those old days when people down in Palm Beach County, Jewish voters, most of them, who had no reason to like Pat Buchanan's politics, voted for Pat by accident because of the crazy ballot.
The butterfly ballot, that's right.
Yeah.
And even Buchanan said after that election, they were not votes for me. He said they were votes for Gore.
It's nice to hear honesty, even in the crudest form. Thank you so much, Steve. Amazing work this week, as I've said. I'm joined now by Ron Meyer, an election law specialist who's associated with the Bill Nelson campaign down in Florida. Jason Johnson, also joining us, politics editor for TheRoot.com. And, of course, and Susan Del Percio, the Republican strategist. Thank you all. Ron, you start, but briefly, because, I mean, we can probably spend a year trying to figure out. By the way, my question, a real simple question, Ron. Why can't the whole country have one measure of voting, one type of machine? We can all be taught, like Mr. Rogers when we're 8 years old, all taught how to vote. And everybody votes the same exact way. It's all counted the same way. It's all on paper. And there's no more of this crapola every election when we're trying to figure out what's going on Tuesday, on Friday. Your thoughts. Is it ever going to happen?
Well, if only we could have, if we could only have one machine and one uniform system countrywide, it would certainly make things more efficient. Look, the Florida law gives supervisors of elections, the 67 of them around the state of Florida, till noon tomorrow to turn in their first unofficial votes. So the fact that we haven't yet got to a final vote point, it's disappointing to those of us who want instant gratification to know who is the winner and who is the loser. But the fact is, the system allows for a deliberative counting process so that everybody's vote's counted. That's what's so important and critical here. The delay isn't anything other than a desire by the supervisors to make sure that all votes are counted and counted properly.
Is there a tranche or category of votes that don't get counted on Election Day by nature because they're overseas or whatever?
Well, we have overseas ballots that come in later. We have a lot of ballots that are being contested as well. Florida has a requirement in the law for signature matches for vote-by-mail ballots or for provisional ballots. And there are no standards for determining whether signatures match. So there are literally tens of thousands of ballots that have been rejected, we submit arbitrarily, by supervisors of elections that need to be counted. These are people who voted properly, and depending on where you live, your vote might be counted or it might not be counted. That's another source of the delay. We'll go into the recount on tomorrow when the first official unofficial results are tendered. We're going to go into a machine recount, and that could very well further alter the results because all of the undervotes and overvotes will be segregated out by the tabulating equipment. And if, as was earlier mentioned, we're less than a quarter of a percent difference between the two candidates, those overvotes and those undervotes will then be physically examined by the canvassing teams to determine whether there's some voter intent that can be gleaned. So this election's not over yet, nor should it be. The statutes contemplate a deliberative process to maximize the number of ballots that are counted. Now, if you're ahead in the polling, obviously you don't want to do anything that might change that result. So those are the kind of delaying tactics and fear tactics that we hear from the people such as Governor Scott, who are right now marginally up in the election. He doesn't want these processes to unfold because it might result in a different result.
Of course, we understand that. Thank you so much, Ron Meyer, for your expertise. I want to bring in to Jason and Susan now. You know, it is such a nostalgic moment in a negative say, because, you know, 18 years ago, and my favorite thing we ever covered around here was the recount in Florida, you'd be people looking up at these ballots, the same exact ballot, and the person who was for Al Gore said, that's a good one. The person who was for Bush, W, that's no good. Same ballot.
Yeah. You would think we would have learned something since high school, right? This is how you count for student body president. Yeah. We should be more advanced. Well, part of the issue here is that there's no uniformity even within the states. Within the states, yeah. There should be some uniformity about how the ballots operate. But the real
problem is... The design of the ballots.
Or how
Why would you put the
in.
Senate vote way down at the bottom left-hand
right.
corner?
And hide it when those are the two races that are driving the top
Unless
of the ticket.
Unless you didn't want to vote for the Senate.
Exactly. And that's what really bothers me about what Rick Scott is doing or what we see that Brian Kemp is doing in Georgia. We have got to find a way. I hope whatever people get into office, regardless of party, find a way to keep these elected officials from toying with and mucking with elections that they are at... that they're on the line for. Rick Scott shouldn't be threatening to send in cops.
Speaking of which, Susan, even before the election, last weekend, we're into this weekend, last weekend, Brian Kemp, the Secretary of State of Georgia, who happens the other job of being a candidate for governor, was claiming fraud there. He was saying there was hacking into the system by the Democrats. And now we have the governor of Florida, also the candidate for the United States Senate in Florida, claiming voter fraud down there because the Democrats want the count to continue till it's done.
Well, here's the funny thing. And just so you know, on that recount, if they move to a hand count in Florida, they have to be separate counts for governor and then a separate count for Senate. So at least two hand counts may be in play, which is just also mind-boggling. But I think what we see here is something that happens when elections are close. Republicans have called for a recount. Democrats call for a recount when it's this close, because we know it can come down to a couple of hundred votes. We should not be, as a country, we should be supporting everyone who voted. People took the time. Right. People took the energy. We had a lot of new voters out there. And we have systems that are changing as well. States are adapting to new rules and regulations as far as absentee ballot or early ballot. So there is a learning curve. Here in New York, we had more paper jams because our ballots were double-sided, and we had a third sheet that we had to reach out.
Same in Maryland, three
so
sheets.
So it's crazy.
Let me ask you about the week and how it looks now, because, God, mid-evening, Tuesday night, we had somebody come on the show and said, no way. But then I say, wait a minute, the Democrats might get twice the vote they needed.
Yeah.
They may get up to over 40 potentially now still. And, of course, they're still picking away at the Senate. They got another Senate seat. They look like they had a good shot out in Arizona. That would mean the two women out west,
exactly.
Arizona and Nevada, both won. That's potential. Mm-hmm. And in Florida, even where it looked pretty dismal election night, the fight's going on.
Yeah, it's a slow-moving wave, right? It's almost like a caravan. It's just moving very slow. Look, here's the thing. Here's the thing I think the Republicans need to understand. It's like, this is why I said this was a wave, and this is why this is dangerous and important Republicans to pay attention to. All of this happened. All of these seats, state houses flipped. The Midwest, which I've been saying all along, the Midwest, these races were so key.
Everybody was Trump's victory area.
Exactly. But people have to recognize this happened with great unemployment. This happened under a great economy. In 2020, if this economy is not doing as well as it is now, Republicans are in trouble.
Did you notice, Susan, that people were like, we didn't even cover these races. They were such sweeps. Mm-hmm. Way before we started counting election night, there were people like Bobby Casey in Pennsylvania by like 10 points. Sherrod Brown, another big victory. Debbie Stabenow. They all swept a reelection in the states that had gone for Trump. And nobody even talked about it because it was a foregone conclusion. Then, of course, the marginal cases came through. But, you know, I'm just wondering whether we missed a big part of the story in not counting with any surprise or excitement all those Democratic victories in the Midwest and the Northeast.
Well, they certainly were tremendous, Chris. But, you know, when we look at polls in the media, we see the horse race. When we look at polls in a campaign, we are constantly looking for gettable votes. And what Republicans saw were there was only the tried and true turnout model of midterm voters, base voters. That's all we could get. The Democrats saw that if they could get their message out, they could reach new voters, they could reach non-traditional midterm voters, and that's where the energy went. And that's really where I think all of us kind of missed seeing this wave coming, is the amount of increased participation with new and non-traditional midterm voters.
Yeah, I also think that Democrats, being people that fall in love rather than fall in line, they do work with their hearts. And there was so much heart in those races that Gillum would win, that Abrams would win, that Beto would win out in Texas. These were long shots. They were heavenly hopes. And because they didn't win with their heavenly hopes, at least not yet in Florida and Georgia, it wasn't a great night. But by any normal standard, when you pick up twice the number of seats and you take over the House of Representatives and the power to set tax law and the power to protect Social Security, Medicare, and Medicaid, and Obamacare, all that power comes from running, controlling the purse strings of the federal government. All won on Tuesday night. Thank you very much, Ron Meyer, Jason Johnson, and Susan Del Percio. Coming up.